concert at about 5 a.m. in the morning, and found her even then to be the lovable rock ragdoll that a legion of fans have since come to love. Here's why they do. Love may be a star now, but the trip to the top hasn't been all fun and free drinks. First, her husband, Kurt Cobain, took his life, and then 2 months later, original Hole bassist Kristen Pfaff died of a heroin overdose.
It was a terrible thing. Yeah, I mean, this great record comes out, and then all this awful stuff.
I'm not psychic, but my lyrics are.
Yeah.
You know, and now, you know, it's, I mean, people go back to work. This is what I do. I got to make a living, and I think I do a pretty good job at it, and I got to go back to work.
So back to work she went, and she certainly wasn't quiet about it. Yeah! Fans followed her exploits in an unending barrage of rumor and tabloid headlines.
You don't hear bad rumors or anything, do you?
Well, Kurt, I mean, everyone's got a bad rumor about me. I mean, it's pretty much a chic. It's actually not so chic anymore. I try to tell people, you know, hey, you're supposed to like me this month. But everyone's got a good Courtney story. I mean, that's, you know, part of my whole thing, right?
Courtney Love has found her place, and her place is everywhere, apparently. Hanging out with REM singer Michael Stipe and Lemonhead Evan Dando, and heaven only knew who else. She rolled around in her underwear at parties, lost clothes and jewelry while stage diving at her own shows, and she was arrested after getting into an airborne shouting match with an Australian flight attendant.
You guys, calm down. This is so silly.
Love's life started out strangely. She was born Love Michelle Harrison in San Francisco on July 9, 1965. Her father, Hank, hung out with the Grateful Dead, and her mother, Linda, became a therapist. Love grew up in places ranging from Oregon to New Zealand. A trust fund baby who attended boarding school, but also spent time in juvenile detention.
What were your experiences in a boarding school? I can't picture you at one of those places.
Well, first I went to the A.S. Neal school called Summerhill, which was the first experimental school. But I was kicked out because the whole idea behind Summerhill was don't go to class if you don't want to. So I didn't. So then I went to a much stricter Catholic, actually it wasn't Catholic, it was Anglican. It was the Church of England school in New Zealand. It was good. It was good. To be honest, the jail part was better because, well, it was heavy discipline, you know. It was like, but the learning, I mean, you know, British school, Scholastic, is so much more advanced than American public school that it's like, you know, they're doing long division in first grade, you know, we're doing it fourth. So by seventh grade, you're doing algebra. So, you know, when I got back here, I skipped three grades.
Before stardom struck, Love worked as everything from a phone sales operator to a stripper in Alaska. She also started getting into bands, including one called Sugar Babylon, which also featured Kat Bjelland, later of Babes in Toyland, and Jennifer Finch, now with L7. She also spent a year in an early incarnation of Faith No More.
Was punk any kind of rebellion for you?
No, because the punk thing for me was more my geography. I was a total Bunnyman, Psychedelic Furs, you know, later Smiths freak. And obviously, I mean, I went to Liverpool, but, you know, I lived on the West Coast. So that was my pool to pull from. And the guy from Pavement came up to me, he's like, "You're so brave." I'm like, "Why?" He's like, "To cover a Bunnyman song." He's like, "I wouldn't have the nerve." You know, and nobody, like, admits, like, the Bunnymen were, like, the greatest band. You know, so I got exposed, you know, I like Social Distortion because they were melodic, but I like Cheap Trick better. So punk rock, you know, like in my marriage, the compatibility, like, okay, at one point we were listening to K-Rock, and they were having one of their great, like, flashback weekends, and Kurt was like, and I was singing every word to, like, The Killing Moon, and Kurt was like, man, this music you used to like, it's so romantic, you know? I was like, yeah, okay.
That's sweet.
But I did like Flipper. Like, we had very common ground with Flipper. But, I mean, Black Flag, none of that. It wasn't me. And I'll be the first to admit it.
Not many people will anymore, yeah.
Well, that's what I think. I think you should admit the embarrassing stuff.
Yeah.
I think the embarrassing stuff it makes you more vulnerable, and it's like, it's cooler.
Yeah.
Stooges, Velvet Underground, yeah, my influences, you know, it's like Butthole Surfers, like, oh, shut up. You know,
Rumors.
Every word to like Pretty in Pink, backwards, you know.
Oh. You guys still fighting ass?
He's real depressed.
Yeah. Jimmy's real depressed too.
How did you come to be involved in Sid and Nancy?
Well, me and my friend Jennifer, we were punk rock extras. And
as a profession? Or
Yeah, that's what we did, like, you know, for a living. And, you know, even, like, in the Gen X book, down to, like, the infamous Quincy Chips episode, me and Finch were in the Quincy. We were in the Quincy episode. You know, I mean, that you couldn't get any more Gen X than that. So we would like get these like big like mohair, you know, their idea of punk with these big funny fake mohawks and stuff, and that's how I met Pat Smear, and I thought it was fascinating because I got to like see movies being made, you know, being from Oregon, whatever, in New Zealand, and so they had advertised, actually they had Alex Cox had advertised in Maximum Rock and Roll and Flipside, and. It was an open call, and I just went, and you know, and there was a scene. The scene you were supposed to try. You had the girl, Nancy had a Harrods bag, and she goes, "Oh my God, I look like Stevie Nicks," in the mirror, and I could really relate to that line. So I did what rather well, and then on my callback, I had a callback, and then I brained Alex with a picture. I brained him over the head, and he kind of liked that, and so I made the short list and. Thank God I didn't get that part. I mean, I wouldn't have been able to have a band.
Yeah, your life would have taken a different direction, obviously.
I mean, I would have been the world's biggest loser, worse than I am. I mean, I would never have been able to have a band. And, you know, then after that, I did that one terrible movie.
And how terrible was it? Well, it was director Alex Cox's post-punk catastrophe, Straight to Hell, which Love was featured with former Clash singer Joe Strummer, Elvis Costello, The Pogues, Grace Jones, and why not, Dennis Hopper.
You ought to show me some respect, baby.
Lena, you know what's the matter? Son, you guys blow the job.
Throw it, tell everyone to shut up. Look out, man.
I ended up making friends with Joe Strummer on that movie, and I never liked The Clash. I never liked The Clash at all. It's totally not, like, it was a boy thing.
Yeah.
To me, you know, and but I really I lived in his basement. I quite liked him, and he was real protective of me, and of all the people around me, he was the only one that was like, I'm going to Minneapolis to start a garage band with my friend, and everyone was like, how could you do that, you know, you're with Triad, you know.
Yeah.
It was horrible. I mean, I was getting sent up for things like casual sex, that movie, the Ivan Reitman movie. It was an awful, awful 3-4 month period, and I just got fatter and fatter and more miserable, and it was like the goal, I guess, was the objective was to be famous for the sake of being famous.
Yeah.
You know, what's that for?
Had you been writing songs all this time?
I'd been writing lyrics.
Mm-hmm.
I wasn't much of a good guitarist. As a matter of fact, Joe Strummer said to me that night in that bar, when I was like, I'm gonna do it, and he's like, you are the worst guitar player I've ever heard. And I only just really started in earnest, but and I have gotten a lot better. But
yeah, you're a good guitar player now. Your guitarist Eric was saying that he learned stuff from you. Yeah.
I am fine. You know, I mean, I'm fine. I have a style, and you know, it's like what's funny is a lot of the songs are complete Bauhaus ripoffs. With total and like my guitar playing is totally picked up from Will Sargent and Johnny Marr. It's like referenced from these British bands, and nobody would guess that because of the sort of persona that I've been put, you know,
well,
it's foisted on me. Like, I guess now, yeah.
Secret's out now.
More tears and laughter with Courtney Love coming up next.
This Tuesday night at 10:30, right after Unplugged, MTV goes Hollywood, spilling secrets that'll turn Tinseltown topsy-turvy. Watch the MTV Movie Awards nomination special, and you could be among the first to get the inside skinny on who's cool, who's hot, who's nominated, who's not, at the only Movie Awards show that matters. The MTV Movie Awards nomination special, Tuesday night at 10:30. It's the feel-good show of the year.
This portion of MTV is brought to you by Ruby Red Squirt, a citrus berry blast. Squirt your thirst.
I'm moving fast, hitting the street, boiling hot, feeling the heat. Throat is parched, ready to burst. Ruby Red Squirt your thirst!
Here's the coolest thing you can do when you're hot.
Squirt!
Drink Ruby Red Squirt, a citrus berry blast.
Different issues.
Different strengths.
Different needs.
It's a revolutionary form of antiperspirant that recognizes the difference between men and women.
It's Secret Ultra Dry, a superior form that will
keep you drier than any other.
Secret, strong enough for a man, but made with ultra dryness for you.
Something is terribly wrong with the children of Midwich.
There have been a few casualties.
Oh, no.
They control your mind.
There are going to be changes.
They control your thoughts.
What are they going to do to us?
And nothing can stop them. Christopher Reeve, Kirstie Alley, John Carpenter's Village of the Damned. Rated R. Starts Friday, April 28th at theaters everywhere.
I was starting in a new school, so of course my face explodes into Monsters, Inc. Just got a first impression I love to make. I can picture my Saturday nights for the next 5 years. It scares me. I wanted to blast those sets.
With Clearasil, you'll have fewer pimples in 3 days and your money back. Guaranteed.
It really worked.
Yeah.
The first day, I looked like everyone else from the neck up. From the neck down, that is another story.
Fewer pimples in 3 days and your money back. Guaranteed.
Getting through college can be a pretty tough climb. To succeed, you need money and you need the right abilities. You can find them both in the Army. If you qualify, you could earn up to $30,000 with the Montgomery GI Bill, plus the Army College Fund. And you could develop the confidence, judgment, and self-discipline it takes to make it to the top, in college and beyond.
And those different mints merging together in a steamy, passionate explosion.
Mint to burst with outrageous flavor crystals. And mint like you never tasted mint before.
Wild, and it should have a warning label.
Yeah.
Unplugged, you know what I'm talking about, like Eric Clapton. Would you hold my hands if I saw you in heaven? I mean, that's the stuff upon which dreams and tears are made. You know, that's the real thing. And it isn't, you know, you can get all those bands and they can be very fancy. I mean, you can get some kind of like cosmic machine, you know, computer type thing. You plug it in and it's like, boom, insta disco. But you know, on the MTV Unplugged, it's like basically you're naked, you know? It's a case of the emperor's naked clothes.
I resent being a role model for marrying a rock star. I want to slap girls when they do that to me. I really do. That's disgusting.
Do people come up and say that to you?
They write me letters about it, yeah, and they say it. Or they'll say, you're my hero, and I'll be why, because you have everything. The cosmopolitan dream.
Yeah. And look what it did, and great.
You know, yeah, well, I mean, I think that it looked like it was headed for doom. Anyway, but it didn't feel like it was headed for doom on a daily basis.
Courtney Love met Kurt Cobain at a punk club in Portland, Oregon in 1989, and 3 years later they married in Hawaii. A
While dabbling in heroin, Love became pregnant, which led to sordid junkie mother rumors and even magazine features. To this day, Love insists she stopped taking drugs when she found out she was pregnant. Their baby, Frances Bean Cobain, was born healthy. A year later, Hole wrapped up its second album, Live Through This, just as Nirvana's third studio album, In Utero, was beginning to climb the charts. In February of 1994, Nirvana mounted a European tour, but didn't get far before Cobain OD'd on alcohol and pills in Rome one night and went into a coma. Courtney rushed to the hospital and then flew home with her troubled husband. The whole album was finally ready for release, and Love was in Los Angeles for it when Cobain killed himself with a shotgun in the couple's Seattle home. At a memorial vigil a few days later, Love, clearly emotionally devastated, read the assembled fans parts of the suicide note he left behind.
I still can't get out the frustration, the guilt, and the empathy I have for everybody. There's good in all of us. And I simply love people too much. So why didn't you just stay?
Then came Kristen Pfaff's heroin overdose. If ever there was any glamour in taking drugs, it was wearing very thin.
Everyone has read William Burroughs, and there's a part in the movie of Naked Lunch where they ask...
Which I wouldn't go see because of my insect phobia.
Well, no, you wouldn't like that movie. But there's a part in there where they say to him, well, what's the connection between writing and drugs? And the implication is that's very close there. And I think a lot of people probably over the years may have been convinced that heroin is a very romantic drug because of Burroughs' work, which is brilliant. But I wonder how many people were steered down the road. What do you think about all that stuff now?
I think that it's really, really, really wrong to romanticize it. I think that part of romanticizing it is even discussing it, but it needs to be discussed. And I think that I'm an icon for it. I get the feeling. I always read accounts of my wastedness. Yeah. And you know, I get drunk sometimes. The other night, 9 inch, I was like drunk off my ass. But heroin, you know, that's not something that I do anymore. And I don't know, it's so chic and cool, you know? Yeah. And everybody approaches it from this very narcissistic approach. I'm the one that can beat it. Mm-hmm. 6 million junkies are wrong. Yeah. I'm the one that can do it. It's like, you know, when I grew up, my parents' friends did acid and pot. Right. They didn't die. I have 9, 10 dead friends, yeah, not including dead lovers and dead husbands and dead band members.
I've been locked inside your heart-shaped box for weeks.
I don't think Kurt wants to be standing in a bardo at the gate as the patron saint of drugs.
Beautiful losers.
Beautiful losers, suicide, and heroin. I don't think Kurt wants to be there. I know that wherever he is, a lot's dissipated, but there's a major guilt left behind. And he's got to have his dignity restored and his true self.
Yeah.
And he could be a real grumpy bastard, but that was part of his power. You know, without saying a word, he could make the whole room feel like it. You know, and he also had an intense narcissism, like, you're coming to me.
Yeah.
But he also didn't have one atom of rock star ego. Yeah. And he needed it. He didn't give himself enough credit. I mean, he knew he was the shit.
Yeah.
At the same time, he didn't give himself. I mean, he prayed every night. He taught our daughter how to pray. One thing that when I would, you know, verbally we would pray out loud is for him to love himself.
Yeah. Why couldn't he, do you suppose?
If he was terminally pouting, I don't know. You know, I don't know. I don't know. I don't know.
Can you like resume a normal kind of romantic life now without people jumping on you?
I don't feel comfortable with it.
No.
Yet. I kind of want Brad Pitt to like get in Kurt's pajamas and run around. How sick is that? But I just keep seeing these pictures. I saw a picture of Brad Pitt today. I'm like, is this, what's Kurt's and Armani? you know. They look uncannily alike. I've never seen him in person. Mm. Michael knows him style, but I don't know. How can you replace a prince?
I mean,
I had a prince. You know, people. She's so lucky. Yeah, damn right, I was lucky. If you don't think I knew that.
Coming up next, Hole on tour, on record, and trying to figure out a future.
Next time on The Max, this primitive plane is all that is real. The other world is a dream where we're trapped. When Julie Winters was hurt, she created a fantasy world for herself, a place where she would have control. You've got to go back there, to the city, find her and protect her. Keep her from knowing too much of the truth all at once, for the truth will destroy her.
Tonight at 11, only on MTV's Oddities.
This portion of MTV is brought to you by Ruby Red Squirt, a citrus berry blast. Squirt your thirst.
I'm moving fast, hitting the street, boiling hot, feeling the heat, throat is parched, ready to burst. Ruby Red Squirt, your thirst!
Here's the coolest thing you can do when you're hot.
Squirt!
Drink Ruby Red Squirt, a citrus berry blast.
Hey, which Charlie's your Charlie? Charlie, the original. It's up, confident, makes you want to go out and change the world. Now there's a new way to Charlie. Charlie Red. Whoa, is it hot in here or is it me? You gotta smell them yourself. Then decide what kind of Charlie girl you are.
Discover all new adventures, all the wonder, all the characters you love in the best-selling Star Wars novels. Thrilled to these all-new adventures, true to the spirit that inspired us all. Read a Star Wars novel today and let the Force be with you. Don't miss these Star Wars novels. Children of the Jedi, new in hardcover, and The Courtship of Princess Leia for the first time in paperback.
When a puck is flying at you at 90 miles an hour, I can't let hunger get in my way, so I grab a Snickers.
Packed with peanuts, milk, chocolate, and caramel. Nothing stops your hunger like a Snickers.
Excuse me, coming through.
Tired of wasting money on an old car that never seems to run right? Tired of getting turned down because of past credit problems? No matter how bad your credit problems are, Guaranteed Auto Credit will give you the financing you deserve. Yes, you deserve both financing and a high-quality late-model car. You get both at Guaranteed Auto Credit. All our cars come with a 2-year warranty. Guaranteed Auto Credit. Call now, 273-1555. That's 273-1555.
When it comes to insurance, millions of Americans are underprotected. They pay billions of dollars annually for uninsured losses. Oh, they have insurance, but not enough. And that's risky. In fact, it's downright scary. Make sure you have the right protection. Call the Allen M. Walker Insurance Agency today, because you shouldn't have to worry about what may be headed your way. Allen Walker Insurance, the protection you need, no more, no less.
I'm Kurt Loder with an MTV News Brief. The prosecutor in the murder case against rapper Snoop Doggy Dogg has revealed that a police computer error has resulted in the destruction of a bullet, shell casing, and bloody clothing that were to be used as state's evidence. The prosecutor says his case won't be damaged since it's based mainly on eyewitness accounts. Snoop's lawyer, however, says the bloody clothing could have been tested to determine whether the rapper was fired upon by the dead man in the case, Philip Waldemariam. The lawyer says he may ask for a mistrial. Snoop's trial is scheduled to begin on April 28th. That's the news for now. More on this and other stories throughout the day here on MTV.
Mine is forever.
I just think Courtney Love is a wicked singer, and her whole group is just, they just stand for themselves, and they're really good.
She speaks what she feels. She doesn't hold back.
I really respect her music, and I think it's really angry and loud, and that's what teenagers like.
Over the past year, Courtney Love and Hole have become stars on the strength of the band's beautifully executed second album, Live Through This, and Love's wild stage presence and tattered baby doll image, pretty much summed up in the album's cover photo.
What I want to capture is the look on a woman's face as she's being crowned, the sort of ecstatic blue eyeliner running kind of, I won! I have hemorrhoid cream under my eyes and adhesive tape on my butt, and I had to scratch and claw and but I won Miss Congeniality. And that's the essence of sickness in this culture that I'd like to capture.
There's a big difference between the first record, you know, Pretty on the Inside, and the second one. I mean, there's a lot of development there. Did you consciously go for a more...
I consciously was self-conscious on Pretty on the Inside, and I was lame. I was competing with my few peers at the time, the people that were really into Sonic Youth and Pussy Galore and Richard Kern, and I felt intimidated by that.
What's Courtney like as a guitarist? I mean, is she...
I think that Courtney is like one of the most amazing guitar players out there. I mean, you know, she has like a really unique sense of rhythm. She plays really hard. Actually, I've learned a lot from her as a guitarist. You should learn how to say no.
I never found a boy that I could play with before. I don't feel comfortable playing with boys.
What's that?
Other than Eric. And I don't sit down with Eric and play. I don't know. I just don't like boys that way.
Oh.
I don't like boys that way.
Oh.
It's weird. I just don't like boys that way.
That is true.
I bet if you asked a guy straight up, you know, do you like sitting down with some boys would say the same thing. I just don't like girls that way. I don't. Huh. There's a sexual thing there. Or, I don't know. I mean, I don't know, but I have a friend who loves to play with her boyfriends. I can never, ever play with my boyfriends.
With Love attempting to pull her personal life back together and a new bassist on board, Hole hit the road with an unsteady set in Reading, England. It was kind of a disaster, but the band improved rapidly.
I feel the band getting like tighter as each date goes along.
Oh yeah, yeah. Like the first show was just, you know, sloppy mess. The second show, sloppier mess. Then all of a sudden, the third show, you know, everything came together.
With her music career in high gear and having just masterminded the soundtrack for the new movie Tank Girl, Love is also getting back into acting with a part in an upcoming Keanu Reeves film.
Now I'm in this dumb movie, Feel in Minnesota. It's not dumb. Did I say dumb movie? It's only dumb because the title comes from a Soundgarden song and there's no G on the end of Feelin'.
Oh, like Feeling Groovy.
Right. I'm hoping it's a working title. Otherwise, I'm purposely going to turn it into The Trip. Keanu has a lot of sex in this movie with everybody.
I like that.
She continues refining her music, too, most recently during a taping for MTV Unplugged.
Well, everything just seems so dramatic and, like, mm-hmm. classy, it being so, I mean, we generally hide behind lots of aggression noise to begin with, and now it sort of seems like we're trying to be mature or something.
Well, I told you from the start just how this would end when I get.
When we play together, it's like we know we're good, And that's what's kept us together, despite my persona being so huge. You know, Patty's got a huge ego. She knows she's a hot drummer. I mean, Kurt, that was Kurt's second choice after Dave. Wow. You know, I mean, Patty's been around Seattle forever. And then, you know, Dave sort of blew Patty away.
Yeah.
I don't think anymore as much, but at that point. And, you know, I mean, Kristen and Melissa now is really good at 22. I mean, she's damn good. And her strength seems to lie less in the classical, but in harmonizing. She's really great at it, 22 years old. So when we play, it's like the Courtney thing goes away, and we know we're hot.
We didn't get into too much trouble.
This portion of MTV is brought to you by Ford and your Ford dealer. Have you driven a Ford lately? And by Sprint, we've got everything you need, local, long distance, and cellular, to let you be there now.
Hey there, Max fans. Don't you go anywhere, because the Max, MTV's oddities, the Max, is going to be on in just 1 hour. But stay right here. Up next, something very special. It's Hole Unplugged.